do that work. At the time, I don't think the connection was made that actually you're increasing the number of children with education healthcare plans as well as new ones coming in, and that the amount of staffing you needed would probably need to increase rather than decrease. So the high needs budget is under pressure with a projected overspend of 2.7 million. This is offset by reserves for the high needs budget. And if we continue to spend in the way that we are, we would end with a deficit of 7 million in 2022. This has been recognised nationally. It's not just a problem for Wirral, it's a problem for all local authorities. And I remember about 3 years going to a SEND conference down in London, and one of my equivalents was saying that she was working with elected members because her deficit was 7 million at that particular time. So until this year, we've been doing very well balancing the budget. We are expecting money from the government around special educational needs to the tune of about 5.4 million coming in. In terms of our SEND population, you can see there the percentage of children with education healthcare plans is above the national average. And we have more children that either have an EHCP or are receiving SEND support compared to the national average. So working out the statistics there, you can see that our SEND support children, that's the intervention before moving on to an education healthcare plan, is higher than national. We have fewer children that are looked after with an EHCP compared to the national, but we have more children that are sent support that are looked after than the national, if that makes sense. So what that indicates is we're intervening earlier and hopefully preventing the need for an EHCP plan for our children looked after unless it's absolutely necessary. A big issue for us is that we have fewer children with education healthcare plans educated in mainstream schools than the average for the Northwest or nationally. And that's primarily due to the fact that we've got some really good special schools. And we have more special schools for a similar size of authority than others. So in terms of the SEND inspection, every local authority will be having an inspection. I think they're about halfway through now. And what they do is they inspect the local area. So this is something that's really important because it's not the local authority, part of it, but there are other partners, particularly schools and health in our area. And there's three areas they look at. The effectiveness of identifying children with special needs, how we meet the needs, and how we improve outcomes. So what I've done is I've gone through each one just to give you a bit of a synopsis of where we're up to. So one of the benchmarks for local authorities was meeting the deadline. All education statements were to be converted to education healthcare plans by, it was supposed to be March 2018, and then they increased it to April 2018 because they realised the enormity of that. And we did pretty well on that. I said the great majority, we only had 12 that weren't, and within 4 weeks they were all completed. We've got additional investment for education healthcare plan coordinator posts, and we've got a permanency there, and that was really important, but because initially we were funding these with a grant, we had a churn in staff because people were moving to areas where they could get permanent positions. We are now, we've got a very robust process in place implemented by the new head of special educational needs to ensure that statutory timescales for completion of plans happen within the 20-week deadline. So it is improving, but we're not yet achieving 100% compliance. However, the satisfaction questionnaires that parents and young people complete once they've got an education healthcare plan indicate that they are pleased with the plan that they eventually get. We've got some strengths, particularly in the early years, where the feedback we've had from parents is that they feel the support is strong and positive. And other strengths that we've got is we have a sense strategic board, which the members are key strategic decision makers from education, health and care. And we've got a SEND operational group, which is probably one of the biggest groups I've ever come across, but everybody is fully engaged and committed to working collaboratively to support children and people who have SEND. We do have some areas of development, and we are committed to ensure that we have a more effective process to complete EHCPs, and we want to improve the timeliness of the plans, but also the quality. And we've got the Department for Education coming to support colleagues in training on that in December. We want to make sure that in terms of the plans, I've read some, and the older plans do not necessarily capture the young person's voice as well as they could, or are written in a way that young people and parents, parent carers can understand. They tend to be in jargon. Education have their own jargon, health have their own jargon, social care have theirs. And it's important that anybody that could pick up a plan could understand what it means. So there's work to do on that. And we're trying to work with all partners to ensure referral pathways are clear and easily understood. The graduated approach that we're looking at, that is the work with mainstream schools, and it centres around quality first teaching and the support that schools should provide to children with special educational needs before it moves on to an EHCP. And an area for us as well is about improving communication with parents and carers. Don't always get that right, and we are listening to feedback from parents and carers in order to improve that. So in terms of meeting the needs, the early years shines out here in terms of parents and being cycled to appropriate health and services. And children, especially those with more complex needs and disabilities, have their needs met more quickly and more appropriately. There's considerable expertise within our 10 special schools, which we need to use more effectively to support our mainstream schools. And we have some school leaders in mainstream schools that are so committed to children with special educational needs that we need to make sure that that is developed in schools that don't necessarily have that confidence, because otherwise, if you're not careful, you have some mainstream schools that connect up with considerably more children with special educational needs. So our areas for development, we do need to work on a strategic approach to pupil-placed planning. And this is particularly with the schools where we have children with complex learning difficulties. We have a significant increase coming through the system. So for example, in July last year, we had 24 little ones that needed to be accommodated into our complex learning difficulty schools. That was, there was about 18 more than we were expecting. So that means there's a knock-on effect all the way through. So we need to make sure that we've got the provision ahead of time when those children get into secondary school, and also looking earlier to see if we do need to increase the number of classrooms that we have, that we can do that ahead of time. We need to develop our management information system so that we can all plan and deliver services more effectively, because we've got different computer systems and information management, and we need to be able to get them to talk to one another more effectively. It was interesting what you talked about, because one of our key areas is working with the local partners to develop preparation for adulthood. So I'm very keen to hear about what Wirral Evolutions are doing, because my argument is preparation for adulthood really needs to start when children are very young, and that we have a programme going through. One of the comments that you get from some of our parents is we're really worried about what's out there for our young people when they're leaving school. So we recognise that, and we want to work collaboratively on that. We do have a SEND strategy which ends in March 2020, so we want to co-produce a new SEND strategy with all partners. And one of the things that we have done is we've now brought a complaints process in-house, and this is to ensure that we can look at the complaints that come in and we can learn from them and change what we are doing, because it hasn't been as joined up as it needs to be, and that will be seen really positively. So in terms of the SEND strategic board, we look at complaints on a regular basis, what the learning is, and we want to see that the changes have been made. So in terms of improving outcomes, you'd expect the easy ones for me are around education outcomes, because that's where I feel most comfortable at, but that's not what it's all about. So we do need children, young people and parents involved in the development and shaping of services. We have a SEND apprentice who is not slowly coming forward and has some amazing ideas on how to improve services. We have feedback from the SEND Youth Voice and in mainstream schools, and they are very keen to help shape services. In terms of the academic outcomes, we've got more SEM pupils meeting the standard for reading, writing and maths. The attainment aid, it is one of the outcomes for GCSE. These are 2018 outcomes because we don't get the SEN outcomes published until January. But you can see there we're at the SEND support, 23rd out of 152 local authorities for our outcomes for SEND support. And for our children, young people with EHCPs, we're at 32nd out of 152 outlays. We've also got more of our SEND support children attaining the grade 4 plus in English and maths, and it's above the national average, as are our outcomes for children with EHCPs. So we've also got some really innovative approaches to the delivery provision in schools and colleges. There's some superb case studies at Wirral Met and Birmingham Sixth Form College. There are bespoke and personalised learning programmes. And it's all about meeting the aspirations of young people, because outcomes aren't all always about academic outcomes. There might be some particular things. It might be for some of the young children, I want to learn to ride a bike, or I want to be able to go swimming on my own, or things like that. So it's important that we look at all that. And the proportion of children that are not in education, training or employment post-16 is below the national average. So that's good, but we won't stop until we've got everybody with an offer and that there's engagement. So we'll be knocking on your door really first. So our areas for development is ensuring outcomes are more aspirational, improving commissioning to enable the co-production of core services. There's a lot of commissioning going on, but for us, we think there's much more strength if we work collaboratively together, and health have got some great expertise in commissioning, which we would like to get to work with and get their support with. There's a couple of areas there for us. Speech and language is one, and CAMS, advocacy and mediation is another. And we just want to make sure that if we get those aspects right, that we'll ensure that our young people have got the skills to go to the jobs market. And the other thing we put there is to strengthen the evaluation of broader education healthcare outcomes through the annual review process. So all education healthcare plans are reviewed annually, but we need to be focusing on the broader outcomes rather than just the academic programs. We do have some risks. And we've called it's the early intervention and preventative work. That's something we want to work on with our schools in terms of we've got the thresholds, document and toolkit to support them, but we don't have the capacity within the SEND department to invest in the intervention aspect of that. So we've got another plan in place about how we're engaging with the special education needs coordinators in schools through the development of locality boards. We've talked about develop dementia as a joint commissioning, that's a risk for us. We can do things better, but we have that engagement. And when I wrote this PowerPoint, we did have inconsistent engagement with the partners at a strategic direction and planning for the semi forms. That has now been addressed, and I'm really pleased to say that we do have that engagement from all parties. So we've got a number of key areas at work. We want to ensure that all the statutory duties related to SenderNet, joint commissioning of services, improving the performance management and intelligence through the IT systems, work with schools on the graduated approach, preparation for adulthood, engagement with parents and carers at all levels, and the review of the SEND strategy. So consultation will be starting after Christmas in terms of all partners being able to give their views on what should be the key priorities in the new SEND strategy.
See what they're doing now. You're using this fitness exercise.
Six, Wellbeing, presentation by Alan Higgins, Head of Programme at Public Health England. Alan, I do apologise, I didn't realise you were at the back. Just as an intro, Public Health England was commissioned by the Metro Mayor to support developments of the City Region Industrial Strategy. Alan, this presents on the impact of poor health has on productivity and the recommendations for Wirral and the Liverpool City Region. Prioritise action to tackle the poor health as a priority for economic planning. Over to you, Alan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I feel like I don't need to say anything. You've done a great job. And I didn't realise you had my name all the way up here as well. I would have taken my seat otherwise. Thank you very much. So let's see if the tech is with me as well.
I think it was just for me.
And it's nearly 12 months to the day since I was here last one telling you about what we were going to be doing through the Wealth and Wellbeing programme. So I'm quite here today to tell you about what we have, but also where I think it's going to go. And the take-home message from this work, this presentation so far, is that we think health should be an imperative in economic planning. If you don't have economic planning, you need to address the health issues in order to make progress. So I'll attempt to show you why. The basis for this programme is pretty simple. You'll all be very well versed in the idea of wider determinants of health. It will have been covered in public health reports over the years. And it will have been established for you that being in work is good for health. It's good for income. It's good for your sense of purpose. And losing work can mean the opposite. In losing, lose a sense of purpose, they lose a sense of structure. That's what happens to many people. And we also know that the way that the economy functions is a determinant of how accessible jobs are to many people and how well people benefit from that functioning economy. And that's the basis of this program. It's looking at that relationship between employment, wealth and health. And what we've done is it more or less boils down to three things over 18 months. One is about establishing connections across the system. I'll tell you a bit more about that in a moment. Another is about establishing a compelling narrative for this story, which is work that's underway and is coming to a conclusion in the next few weeks. And the third, which I'll begin with, is providing an evidence case on health and productivity and action for the local industrial structure which sits across the Liverpool City region. And it brings together quantitative evidence, the quality of evidence as well, and the evidence for interventions, and put it together in a productivity and health report which was then sent out to yourselves and widely across the Liverpool City region. And it was making a number of challenges, which is to say, if you accept the data analysis, which says that this is a priority for health is a priority, and if you take on board the evidence base, which is never quite conclusive, but it gives us a fair range of things that the evidence says we should, then what we'll be looking for health well-being boards is how we go about addressing this. Because of course it'll be different in Wirral and different in Sefton and different in various other places, depending on what you've done already, but also depending on your population. So that's what I'll be looking particularly from health well-being boards and others that we'll speak to. So I'll go back a bit just to say what we have done. In November last year, we were very fortunate this program in that a national report came out which was produced by the Northern Health Science Alliance, which is a group of eight universities stretching from Liverpool University across to Hull. And they produced a report which is, I think it was called Health is Wealth or Wealth is Health, and it put a figure on the part that health plays in the low productivity of the boroughs across the North England, especially compared to the rest of the country. And key findings, productivity is low in the North, the key reason that health is also worse in the North. And the sixth bullet point down there is a key one for us. It says improving health would reduce the £4 gap in productivity per person per hour between the northern part of us versus the rest of England by 30%, or £1.20 per person per hour. So they did the calculations, they costed out that there's a productivity gap between those northern versus the rest of the country, which equates to £4 per hour. Did a further analysis which showed that poor health actually explains 30% of that gap, or £1.20 per hour. And that's a lot. That's a big part of that productivity gap that's explained by poor health. And, we then went on to apply that analysis to Liverpool City Region. Because one of the senior academics on the programme works at the University of Liverpool, Ben Moore, he did the work for us. And I'll not go through much of that, because I think you know that. But the final bullet point on the bottom right, where that gap was 30% for Northern Wales and the rest of the country, when you work that same analysis for Liverpool City Region, it comes to 33%. So health is even more important as an explanatory element in productivity and health for Liverpool City Region. And Greater Manchester picked up on this as well. We did it first. They then thought, we need to know what it is in Greater Manchester too, because they did their independent prosperity review, which majored on that Northern Health Science report as well. Interesting, the finding in Greater Manchester is that health, poor health, only explains about 13% of the productivity. And that's something to do with having a different pattern of commuters travelling into Greater Manchester, different industries as well. We're still trying to understand quite why that is such a difference. What we're convinced, because we ran the figures again, because the first thing being, wait, we've got it wrong, we ran the figures again. We're convinced that this is 33%. Possibly that's even an underestimate. It also means that in terms of Liverpool City Region, it's almost unique in being different from Greater Manchester in having health as such a key factor in looking at economic growth and productivity. We also got a figure for this, which comes out to a pretty staggering 3.2 billion in terms of GVA per year, gross value earnings, as a measure of economic productivity. That's for Liverpool City Region. That's down to per health, which is 10% of the overall. where we produce this data. We got people who were producing their local economic, local industrial strategy to set up. Prior to that, they were a bit bemused at the thought that health had anything to do with economic planning. We got their attention through having this kind of data. So set that aside for a minute. What we also started in January this year were a programme of 6 workshops to help people connect with other people who are doing some work around or have an interest in wealth and well-being, worklessness, and so on. And partly we did that because it felt that where there was elements of good practice, people didn't know about what else was happening either within their program or elsewhere. And these 6 workshops have been surprisingly good. And it's almost each time I go to them, I get in there and I think, I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen, why we brought all these people together, but they seem to work. We get 35, 40 people there. And when you bring people together, give them lunch, they talk, and the buzz in the discussions is fantastic. We were in Birkenhead in early April, looking at the economic impact of the health and social care sector, how we could improve that, change it. Very good discussions there. So those are happy in the feature. We've got one more to go in September, 25th of November. And what we'd hope to do is say that this is something that we should keep going in the future. And that if you set the conditions right, people are interested and willing to talk about economy and wealth. Another thing we've done, which is underway, is create this compelling narrative for what we're hoping will be a compelling narrative for writing this issue. And you'll know if you've been involved in large-scale change, you need a good story. And what we're trying to do is build this story up from people who are either workers through ill health or are managing to stay at work but have got a chronic health condition. So we're asking people, what is it that means that you are actually able to stay there? These are emerging findings. It's all going to be turned into a lovely 3 to 5 minute animated video, which will be much more easy to digest as well as to report. 4th bullet point down, it's the small things. This is somebody saying they've got a chronic health condition. What helps you stay back in work or get back into work? Small things, little changes improve the wider workplace well-being. Example, not being questioned about why they've been offered, awareness of others' needs. And that speaks to some kind of cultural issue about people being supported to get back into work. Looking at the interventions, this is not concluded yet. There's still work to do in this, but it feels to us that there's 4 domains that are important to work in: employment and workplace, individual, community, and the public economy itself. These offshoots from this are some of them are evidence-based, some of them are good practice. But we know about fair employment charter. It's important to ensure that as many people as possible are paid a living wage, it's healthy workplace charter. Because we know 8 or 9 features of jobs, that means that if people are employed and are valued, their skills are recognised, they're doing work that suits their skills, then they will be happier in that work. It's more health enhancing work. There's a role of health institutions, which I'll come back to at the end. There's also things that can be done to support individuals, and this tends to be where there is the best evidence. These also tend to be things that are floated around health service input. So there's the individual placement and support service around the left. There's 20 years or so of evidence about how this works in supporting people with severe mental illness to go back into work. Modified IPS is about taking the similar approach but making it more appropriate to people with less severe mental illness. Moving around to early health services is about recognising that if you can support people at an early stage, going off on sick leave, before they get to the point where perhaps they've been off for 6 weeks, then it's more likely that they will get back into work. The service that's been developed in Greater Manchester is about working with primary care, with GPs, to pick up people who are getting to that point of going off for extended sick leave and to intervene at an early stage to help them get back into employment, or to not leave employment in the first place. There's a whole range of community-based interventions, which I know are particularly strong in world, the community connectors program. It's a very strong programme that's going to be important in this sense of enabling people to get back into something close to the workplace. And this is particularly for people who have been workless for some time. There's some distance from the marketplace. If you've got a programme of community connectors, volunteering, asset-based community development, you're more likely to help those people get closer to the point where they can take up training and get closer to finding employment again. last one, is around the way that the economy actually functions. And this is something which we've developed over the last 18 months, by no means the first to do it, but we've picked up on what other people do. There's a whole part that anchor institutions, as in those organisations that are large and fixed, and the health and care services, one of these things, universities or another, they're not going to leave the area. They're established that they're large employers, they have contracts with businesses. And there is something that those institutions can do to support local economy to a greater extent than has probably been done already. The notion of well-being economics is a very attractive one. It's one that's been picked up internationally by, say, New Zealand government, where they now have well-being outcomes as the main focus of their economic budgets. Also being developed through Scotland, Wales has got the Future Generations Programme, which tends to focus in the same direction. So we're wondering just how would that work for a combined authority and its plans for the economy. The social economy is very important in the Liverpool city region, but could also be highlighted to a greater extent in local economic planning. And one of the things we've been discussing with particularly foundation trusts in Liverpool city region is to say, well, what would you want from economic planning that would enable you to meet your goals around health improvement? And as large institutions, you should have a voice in saying what the economic plan should be, how the economy should be run, so that there aren't people losing out, and that everybody benefits. And that's an interesting discussion which we're just getting our heads around. But it feeds into a sense that the health and social care sector, the health and wellbeing sector, ought to have a voice and an opinion on how economic planning is done in order to produce healthier people, reduce the number of people losing out through health inequalities. That's pretty much as far as we've got. These are the four themes in the current LCR Local Industrial Strategy. It's currently under consultation, due for completion by next March. It feels that we've had an achievement to get good work, health and well-being there as a key theme. But we know that you can win the argument once, but then you've got to keep winning it again. We need to keep it there so it's still there by next March. And we need to provide them with content behind those things, which will be some of those interventions. But we're also looking to engage with any further, because you'll have within the council a programme around economic development and getting work and regeneration. And we need to engage those people and say, well, how are you taking on board health and wellbeing in your economic plans? There's a workshop coming up, yet another workshop, December the 3rd in the morning, runs from 9:30 to 1 p.m. We'll give you lunch again at the end. It's also going to be in the Mansion House in Collison's apartment, and what better place to be in a nice frosty December morning than there. And that's where we'll pull together the information that we've got from the public narrative on good work, health and wellbeing for all, learning from those six system connection workshops. Hearing, I'll be feeding back from what we've heard from presentations like this about where people's interests are in taking this forward. Raising links to the Green System and Sustainability programmes, setting an agenda for the next 18 months of wellbeing economics. But also that's this feeling of growing expectation and momentum for change. The more we talk to people, the more interested people are in engaging with this subject. Next steps, ensure we've got this as a priority theme that stays within the local industrial strategy. Develop our policy and improvement intervention propositions. Some of those things we come up with can be costed. There's evidence about where they're working elsewhere. Some can't, but we'll develop the ones that can be costed. Capture the benefits of systems leadership. Try to get it across into the local industrial strategy. But the more you talk to people, the more and better informed your ideas will be. And to work with partners in LCR, we want to develop these ideas. A couple of questions to think of. Of course, you can pick up your own questions. But I'm wondering, if we're saying health is an imperative in economic, what does it mean to health and well-being? Could and maybe does the world plan for the economy have well-being as overall goal? What would it be if you did? And what do you want from this local industrial structure that's being developed in LCR but also in the world in terms of global development? Last point, if you haven't received an invitation to that workshop on the 3rd, then please email me and ask for an invitation and I will be sure.
something that's very close to our hearts. I think we've done a lot of work in the world around supporting people back into the employment, back into employment. That's where the community connectors came from, because we challenged ourselves around doing something different. A number of you spoke at the event that we had in Istanbul earlier in the year around anchor institutes. I'm really hoping that this piece of work, A, Rachel sits on the regeneration board and we've been doing this work in and through that locally, but I think more importantly for me, we're having a conversation at the moment around the health and wellbeing board. What is its role in the future? I'm going to put my cards on the table and say, I really hope that this is one of the things that the health and wellbeing board actually picks up and starts to champion and also challenge what is happening around the really exciting regeneration plans that we've got in the borough. It's a really good piece of work because it's brought that evidence together, and with the narrative that's going to be developed as well, that gives us a real rounded picture of why it is so important to think.